Hello, my friends. Judgment Day, the day after, plus 37. Could you imagine that there has been already 37 days since the abolishment of the state of emergency in Serbia? Yeah, difficult to believe. The corona or COVID is not yet gone. On the contrary, it seems that it intends to stay with us for a longer period of time, even during summer. The past 10 days we have been recording 50 to 100 cases, between 50 and 100 cases of corona, but however, honestly speaking, there are no serious cases. So mostly, I mean, 90 something percent people with light symptoms. So it's not the same virus anymore, but it could be still little for the elderly, I guess, and for the people with reduced immunity. I don't know how many of you know, there was a guy called Esad Pasha Topani actually, an Albanian officer who was murdered on today's date in Paris in 1920. He was supposed to go after that meeting in Paris, he was supposed to go to Albania and declare himself a king of Albania, but there is one other Albanian guy had different opinion about it and killed him in the middle of Paris. He was a friend of Serbs. This is an interesting thing about him. During the Ottoman Empire, he was one of the officers of the Ottoman Empire. I mean, during the period during which Albania was part of the Ottoman Empire. And then after the Balkan Wars, he realized that he practically declared a couple of times the Albanian state, I mean the independence of Albanian state. However, these declarations were not really, I mean, recognized by the other forces other than Kingdom of Serbia. He realized that Balkan states should belong to Balkan people, and hence in this regard he had similar ideas as the Serbian rulers back then. So he formed practically an alliance a secret alliance with Nikola Pašić during the First World War. Nikola Pašić and Serbs helped him, armed his forces with weaponry, etc., his gendarmerie. And he managed to fight his way to the throne from the Prince of Albania. Practically defeating the other army of the Albanian, so Prince army practically, and capturing a lot of arms, weapons that were practically sent by the Austro-Hungarians to Albania in order to secure the death of Serbia, the defeat of Serbia in the First World War. However, this guy actually practically helped. So first, the Serbs helped him, also with some troops, in order to gain this victory and gain again parts of the Albanian territory back. And he was also, during the withdrawal of the Serbian troops, he was helping the Serbian army protecting the flanks from the attacks of Bulgaria. But before that, actually, even the three powers, Bulgaria, Ottoman Empire, and the Austro-Hungarian Empire, was practically trying to pursue him to change sides and to become part of the Axis forces. However, he resisted these attempts. Unfortunately, during this period when he also said no to the Ottoman Empire, he lost popularity with the Muslim part of the Albanian people. Although back then he declared the state called Islamic Emirate of Albania or something. I mean, roughly translated, this was the name. But as I said, due to the fact that he said no to the Ottomans, who also tried to involve him in the First World War at the side of the Axis forces, he was not anymore popular, so there were issues, and eventually when Serbian troops were forced to withdraw through Albania, also practically had to go out of Albania when Austro-Hungarians started capturing also parts of the Albanian territory. On the other side, the French and Italian troops captured the coastal parts of Albania, and he fled initially to Italy, but then when Italy was trying to convince him that practically Albania should become a vassal state of Italy, he went to France, and then from France he returned with his around 1,000 gendarmes, and he fought the Thessaloniki front in the First World War, practically helping also the Serbian troops to breach the front. I believe many people do not know this, but yes, even these troops were quite good. I mean, the soldiers were very good, and they helped the Serbs to breach the Thessaloniki front. But obviously, I'm trying to make a parallel between the Serbs and Albanians. Serbs were also very well known for killing their own rulers. I already mentioned in two of my Facebook posts the murder of Knez Mihailo, the ruler that is practically now very popular with Serbs, because one of the main streets in Serbia, I mean the pedestrian zone in Belgrade, is carrying the name of Knez Mihailo. But they also, I mean the Serbs also murdered Aleksandar Obrenović in 1903, in this event that is known as the Majski Prevrat in Serbian. I'm not sure about the English translation. Actually, this thing happened in June, but because of the fact that back then official calendar in Serbia was still, this was 1903, official calendar was still the Julian calendar, the one that is still being used by the Serbian Orthodox Church. As you know, this calendar is 2 weeks behind the Gregorian calendar. So this is called in the May, practically, not rebel. Prevrat is very difficult to understand even in Serbia, in Serbian language. So therefore, I definitely do not know the English term. So yeah, obviously the Albanians, and unfortunately they killed the very guy who wanted to have good relationship with Serbia. The secret alliance that he signed with Nikola Pašić also included joint defense, joint central bank, many things. Practically it was supposed to be a kind of a confederation between the two states. The Albanians would then have this secured northern line, and the Serbs would have at least one of the borders free of enemies, given the fact that back then all other borders were surrounded more or less by enemies. I mean, the Austro-Hungarians, the Bulgarians, that started being our enemies after the end of the first Balkan War. I was explaining already why it was that. And yeah. Okay, we are now in New Belgrade, next to the Siv building. see one, I mean the main building. I don't know how many of you know, but the interior, some of the interior works of this building were done by the Italian craftsmen as a mean of war reparation for the Second World War. I found out from a guy who practically also a craftsman who went to do some reparation, and he said that one of the best, I mean, masterpieces of craftsmanship he saw there, especially the parquet, who was 10 centimeters thick, so practically was supposed to be eternal. Okay, that much for now. I hope you enjoyed this story that probably many of you did not know about. And talk to you soon again. Bye bye.